Hi, everyone. I am Donna Reed, and this is Donna Reed Talks Voice. And we have an episode that's a follow-up to the series with Rebecca. I've been working with Rebecca for, at this taping, 10 months now. And a couple of weeks ago, she did a recital where she sang beautifully, by the way. And there were two pieces that I wanted to point out and put on my YouTube channel so that you can hear what's been going on with her chest voice, the low notes, and you could hear what's been going, what one can do with the different styles of singing. As I've been saying many times with my YouTube channel here and whoever wants to listen to me, you can sing any style you want to. You can go from one thing to another. We're going to have her go from an aria to a musical theater piece. So the first piece that we're going to do is from The Marriage of Figaro, and it's called De Vieni Non Tardar. And again, you'll hear what she does. There's one passage in it where the low notes are very prominent, which she does very, very well. So we're going to play that one first, and then I'll ask Rebecca to come on and we'll discuss a little bit of it.
Thank you.
Hi, Rebecca. How are you?
Hi, I'm good. How are you?
Very good. Now, what did you experience? Let me ask you this. When you experienced the De Vieni, because I know in the private lessons, we've been working on that one phrase that goes down with the low notes. What did you experience with that, and how was it different than you've done before?
The low notes, like the way we were working on them, they didn't feel as disconnected to everything else I'm singing in that piece than before. Like before, I felt like they were very chest voice sounding and not classically sounding at all, and they felt like a very different part of my voice. And the way we were working on it, I feel like now it's kind of coming together and everything feels like it's one voice, even though we're mixing differently, of course, if we're down there or like up in the other parts of that piece. But it feels a lot more natural and connected.
And you brought up a very good point. The chest voice that you would use for that particular piece, for those low notes, is very different kind of chest voice than you would use for musical theater on the same notes. So there's not just a chest voice, there's not just a head voice, there's different mixes of each one depending on what it is you're singing. So one can't sing, let me put it this way. I've had several students who say they've been classically trained, but they're in musical theater. So what they tend to do is maybe overly round the vowels. And if you overly round the vowels, because you're classically trained, but then you're trying to sing musical theater, that's kind of not going to work because you're going to work against the sound that you need for the genre that you're singing. You can then shift, as you did in this piece, shift and have that more classical sound without it being overly rounded or covered sounding, which you don't ever sound in the De Vieni, and then broaden it up and get a little bit more of a mix, which we're going to see in the next piece for musical theater. And one thing I do want to point out to my listeners is in working with Rebecca, what I've noticed is that she is extremely self-aware. Now, of course, my job is to point out certain things and get her to try this, that, or the other thing. But she's very self-aware as to, oh, I see that worked. No, that didn't work. When she works on her own, every lesson she'll say, okay, I tried this and I tried that and I tried the other thing and I noticed this and I noticed that. The key to anybody working on their own voice, and of course, in most cases, you need a teacher to help you along. But the key is to be very, very self-aware and to know exactly what you're doing to get something, to get a particular sound. Do you have any comment on that aspect of it?
Yeah, while you were speaking, I was just thinking about it when I'm working. And I feel like over the course of the week, I'm just gathering problems that I encounter. And then I'm coming to you and just saying, okay, this worked, this didn't work, this didn't work. And then you have like, always like a different like view and approach and idea, so I don't get stuck in like my own way of doing things, because if I was just working on my own, there wouldn't come as much of like a new idea or like a different approach to something. So yeah, that's definitely helpful, and I feel like you get used to it being a good thing when things don't work out, because that's how you get to find your things. You have to like be brave enough to try different things and to fail and to feel like, okay, no, that's just not my journey. But to find, to like get to that point, you have to be brave enough to just try everything. And I feel like that's working really well. If I can just like check in with you every week and then you can help me again.
Yes, absolutely. I'm going to quote Cornelius, my late husband, as I've done before, you have to have the courage to be bad before you can be good. And
yeah, definitely.
Siren, everybody, because this is New York City. I hope you heard what Rebecca said, despite all of that siren, because what she said was very good. Now I'm going to introduce the next piece, which is She Used to Be Mine from Waitress. And you'll hear what Rebecca does with that and how very different a style that is, obviously, from the De Vieni. So we'll play that one now.
It's not simple to
The one thing that I want to comment on this next piece, the very first thing is I can see how you really feel this piece very deeply. Your interpretation of it for me is just beautiful. I could see that you love this piece. Not that you didn't love the De Vieni, you did that very, very well. But there's a passion, you're really connected to this. So before I even talk about it technically or anything, do you have anything to say about that?
Yeah, I feel like it's a bit easier for me to like get in the headspace of what's going on in She Used to Be Mine. I feel like it's easier to connect that to like my own life and everything, even though I'm not a baker and pregnant and dealing with an abusive husband. But it's closer to what Susanna is doing, which she is sitting in the garden and like waiting for her lover to come while everyone is dressed as a different person and there's like all of these different things going on. So I feel like the opera is a bit more like kind of artsy and not as as natural, kind of, as she used to be mine for me. So.
And again, you do it so beautifully. The one comment I'm going to make is the low notes are certainly better. For me, they could be even just a little bit more free, a little bit. But again, you know, when you listen to most people do it, they're not very loud with those low notes. You know, it's very almost whispery. It's almost talky. Stylistically, that's absolutely correct. And that's absolutely fine. My personal taste, I would just like a little bit more chest voice in there. So let me ask you this. Was that a stylistic choice to just kind of be a little bit more kind of, I don't want to say breathy, but a little less chesty with it? Was that stylistically what you wanted to do? Or would you like a little bit more chest voice on those bottom notes, the very beginning of the piece?
I actually would like a bit more chest voice. It was like I have been singing for half an hour and mostly classical pieces at like 2 octaves higher sometimes. And so I was kind of figuring everything out because I felt like, okay, it's better to do less but have it work than to try to do more and then have it not work. So that was like kind of my approach to that recording that happened there.
Makes perfect sense. So we do what we can with our voices where they're at the moment. And then we make an artistic choice accordingly. Again, ideally a little bit more chest voice. Yes, you would like that too, but fine, it worked beautifully. Now I want to bring up a point that you told me personally. I'd like you to expound upon it here. You mentioned to me before that when you work on this mixy, beltier stuff, the low notes seem to get a little easier.
Yeah, definitely.
So that tells you that when you've got the right mix in the middle and you've got the right chest voice in the middle, then the low notes get easier. Now, I remember you're saying that after you sang this piece, then you felt your low voice was working better for you.
Yeah, I actually sang this piece twice because we didn't have anything else prepared and they wanted to hear something else. So we just did that piece twice. And the second time around, I felt like the chest voice was already a bit more relaxed and like everything worked a bit better.
Great. So that tells you when one does the right mixing of the chest voice in the middle in this mixy belty style, if it's correct, it's going to help the low notes. It's also going to help the high notes. Also, what I find, and one of the reasons that singing classically can throw off this mix is that, and you didn't do this in the piece that you sang in the De Vieni, what people do in the classical, I mentioned it earlier on, is they get overly round. So the classical people don't put enough chest voice in the middle parts of their voices. It's all kind of covered and ends up being like this. But that's not how it should be. There should be that little bit of chest voice, obviously not musical theater chest voice, but that little bit of chest voice in there that doesn't knock out the low chest voice altogether. So what have you been discovering with this working on your chest voice? Is there any point, you know, in these last 10 months that is most prominent to you that you think of most?
I feel like the most prominent thing maybe that those two styles are not as different as I always like expected them to be or handled them. Because like a lot of ideas that come quite naturally to me when I'm doing the musical and the belting and everything, I'm starting to use also for the classical stuff. Of course, I'm not belting in the classical pieces, but like this kind of energy and like being there and in the moment and with the body and everything works for the classical stuff as well. And so, yeah, also some heady parts in the musical, it's fun to do like the more classical approach to it because not everyone can do it if they just always belt and sing loud and everything, and then to just go back and do this really fine heady stuff, it's also really fun. So I'm experimenting a bit with like how much can we combine it, what can we learn from the one thing, and what can we like transpose like to the other. So yeah.
Exactly. You know what? That's fabulous. I could not have stated it better because that is what I am all about. Being flexible, playing with these blends, making sure that, okay, well, I've got this big old chest voice belty thing, but how do I turn that to a head voice? Or I've got this beautiful head voice. How do I add more chest voice? The mixing of these two registers. So how one mixes the chest voice and the head voice, those two mechanisms, those two basic sounds, is the key to everything. Not where your voice is placed, not how you're supporting, not all of that superficial stuff. It's what am I doing? How chesty is it? How heady is it? How do I personally experience that? And how do I mix and match depending on what I'm singing? So thank you so much for, again, allowing me to work with you this way and being taped and showing it to my my listeners out there. And I think you're doing amazingly well, and we'll just keep working on it and see if we can't get it even better.
Yeah, thank you so much, really. It's like such an amazing journey, and it's so fun and so creative. And yeah, I'm really happy.
And that it should be fun. Everybody who sings, it shouldn't be a burden. It should be fun.
Yeah, definitely.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Rebecca.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching Donna Reed Talks Voice. If you have any questions for me about this episode, or if you'd like to join me on a future episode, please visit DonnaReedTV.com and click Contact.